Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sickness, a Post-Apocalyptic Survival Thriller by Kellee L. Greene. Narrated by Patricia Santomasso. Chapter 1. My life hadn't ever gone according to plan. When I was a young girl, I imagined the person I'd be. But I wasn't anything like what I'd pictured. I married my high school sweetheart. He was the only person I really ever dated, if you could even call it that. But he wasn't my Prince Charming, not even close. Hell, I was pretty sure there was no such thing. Freddie was an alcoholic monster, who was absolutely miserable and wanted everyone else to feel that way too. The only good thing that ever came out of our marriage was Maddie, my 17-year-old daughter. I was stuck with him because I was unable to afford to find a place for my daughter and me. It wasn't like he'd ever let us leave anyway, at least not without a fight. Not to mention, there wasn't a single landlord in our small town that would rent to me because I didn't have a steady job or an income of any kind. I promised my daughter that one day soon we'd get a place, but sadly, I'd been saying that for more than a year. It was difficult because I didn't want to hate her father. All I wanted was for Freddie to change back into the person I first fell in love with. Most of all, I wanted him to be a father. But that wasn't going to happen. I wasn't sure what changed Freddie, but he had no desire to go back to who he'd been. Freddie liked who he was now, even though everyone else hated him. If that wasn't bad enough, my mother had been diagnosed with breast cancer just under a year ago. It was bad. It was aggressive. They didn't give her long to live, but she was fighting her losing battle like a champion. It hadn't been more than 10 minutes since Freddie had left for work. The house was quiet, peaceful, but the walls were stained with bad memories that constantly haunted me. I chugged down my mug of black coffee like it was the last time I'd ever drink it. What I really felt like doing was slipping back into my pajamas and sliding back into my warm, cozy bed. A knock at the door interrupted my scrolling through the news on my phone. Shootings, politics, drunk drivers. Same news, different day.
Miss Kit!
My elderly neighbor shouted at the glass of the front door. Her nose was nearly pressed right up against the dirty pane.
Miss Kit, are you home?
I chugged down the last of my coffee and drew in a breath as I pushed myself away from the small, scratched-up round table. It was one of the first pieces of furniture Freddie and I had bought together. I quickly pasted on a smile and opened the door. Good morning, Mrs. Wheaton, I said. My teeth felt like they were turning into hard kernels of corn as the breeze blew into the house, drying out my mouth. Is there something I can help you with? I already had a good guess why she was at my door.
Oh dear, you won't believe what happened again, but Maxwell Lewis has climbed into your big tree again. He won't come down, even for his favorite treats,
Mrs. Wheaton said, rubbing her dry, scratchy hands together. I glanced toward the tree over her small, sagging shoulder.
If it wouldn't be too much trouble, I could really use your help. You're just so good at convincing him to come down.
Yeah, of course, I said, looking back toward my empty cup of coffee. When I got back inside, I was going to need another mug or two. Mrs. Wheaton held my arm as we walked across the front yard.
Looks like your husband is behind on mowing the yard. Maybe that's why Maxwell Lewis likes to come over this way. He's looking for mice.
I swallowed hard. He's been busy with work. Freddie could take the blame, even though 80% of the time I was the one mowing the yard because he was passed out after dinner in the recliner. Of course, Mrs. Wheaton likely already knew I was the one that did most of the yard work. It was just her passive-aggressive way to tell me to cut the damn grass. She was also incredibly nosy. Maybe she was hoping I'd talk about what was going on. It wasn't like she hadn't heard our fights next door. The walls of our cheap homes weren't that thick. Hell, the neighbors across the street had probably heard us from time to time as well.
Oh, no doubt he works hard. My husband is a plumber, so I know what it's like.
A fact she worked into nearly every conversation we had. He'd died over 3 years ago, but sometimes I wondered if she still thought he was alive. Freddie wasn't a plumber, though. He worked in construction. Long hours in the summer, thank God, and not enough money to pay our bills in the winter. I hated winters. With it being mid-September, it wouldn't be long before Freddie's workload would start to slow, and he'd be home more. It was definitely not something I was looking forward to.
"There he is," Mrs. Wheaton said, pointing at the same spot good old Max the cat liked to run off to whenever he got the chance.
I was pretty sure Maxwell Lewis had needed a break from his pet parent and would come down when he was good and ready.
"Poor thing, he must be so frightened."
"Yeah," I said, walking over toward the fence that was half-coated with green and yellow mold. The ladder was still leaning against it from the last time I'd had to get Maxwell Lewis out of the tree. I rested the ladder against a thick branch near the tree trunk and checked to make sure it was steady. My first step was cautious, but my second was braver. It wasn't long before I was face to face with fluffy Maxwell Lewis's smirking face. "Don't look at me like that," I said softly. Maxwell didn't stop grinning. "You might as well stop climbing up the tree. Every time you do, I just have to come up here and get you. This isn't fun for either of us, is it?" Maxwell Lewis slowly blinked at me. "Oh, huh? Maybe it is fun for you."
"Is he okay?"
Mrs. Wheaton shouted in her squeaky old woman voice that barely made its way up the ladder to my ears. "Yes, he's fine," I said, hugging him to my body with one arm. Maxwell Lewis locked eyes with me for a moment. "You stay because she keeps you fed." "I know. I get it. It's a tough world out there." At the bottom of the ladder, I scratched Maxwell Lewis's head. Maybe he was just as trapped as I was.
"Would you be a dear and bring him over?" Mrs. Wheaton asked. "He's just so rambunctious these days that I'm afraid he'll get away from me and bolt right on back up that tree. I don't want to have to bother you again today."
"Of course," I said, and she grabbed my elbow while I held on to Maxwell Lewis. Mrs. Wheaton nodded her head at the house across the street.
"He works really hard, but look at his lawn. It's perfect. Not a single creeping Charlie anywhere to be seen."
I was tempted to take Maxwell Lewis back up into the tree and hide from Mrs. Wheaton with him. Instead, I put mowing the lawn on my to-do list.
"Would you like to stay for some tea?" Mrs. Wheaton asked. "I have some fresh croissants I could offer you. Well, fresh from a day or two ago, I think."
"I'm sorry, I can't. I'm expecting a call from my sister any minute," I said, tapping my back pocket to check for my phone.
"Oh,"
Mrs. Wheaton said, unable to hide her disappointment.
"Send your daughter over later. I'll wrap them up for her."
I smiled, but I already knew I wouldn't be able to convince Maddie to spend time with Mrs. Wheaton, even if I paid her. It would take something far more enticing than some stale croissants to get her to visit. "I'll let her know," I said, waving as I walked backward away from her house. I pointed at Maxwell Lewis. "Don't let him escape again."
"He's a sneaky one,"
Mrs. Wheaton grumbled as she closed the door. Maxwell Lewis watched me until the door closed. As I made my way back home to search through the want ads for the 33rd week in a row, my palms started to sweat. It wasn't because I knew the jobs hadn't changed in our small town. They never did. It was because I was worried about the phone call I was waiting for from my sister. I suddenly had appreciated the distraction Mrs. Wheaton had given me. It had been exactly 1 week since my sister, Polly, took our mother to New York to receive a new drug. She'd been one of the first of a group of patients accepted into the promising new study. Our mother believed it was her only hope. 5 days ago, she arrived. The same day she was injected with the drug. Today, roughly an hour ago, She'd been due for a checkup. If the cancer hadn't started to shrink, it would be bad news. Bad news at a very high price tag. I hadn't given much, but what I had given was all we had left. Freddie had gone ballistic when he found out what I'd done. Polly and her fiancé had given an amount of money that would have made Freddie pass out, and not from drinking too much. The amount of money would have been enough for Freddie and me to live on for several years, in addition to sending Maddie to college. When the phone rang, I nearly jumped out of my skin. My fingers were like wet sausages as I tried to pick up the phone. "Yes, hello?" I said, mashing the words together into one.
"Were you out for a jog?" Polly asked.
I could imagine her pinched expression as she stared at the phone. "No," I said smoothly. "You know, I don't get exercise." She chuckled.
"That's right. Were you in your creepy basement and had to run up the stairs because it felt like something was following you?"
"Yeah, that's exactly what I was doing," I said, rolling my eyes. I didn't want to chit-chat. I wanted to hear how our mom was doing. "How was the checkup?"
"Everything is looking good. The cancer has shrunk nearly 50% in just this short time," Polly said.
50% or 15%? I asked, making sure I'd heard her right.
50,
she said, enunciating the word carefully. My mouth instantly dried. That's insane.
No, it's amazing. Do you realize what this means for people all over the world?
Polly asked.
Hoyt needs to invest in this company as soon as possible. It'll help pay for the wedding.
Maybe I should invest in it. Polly cleared her throat. Oh, right. I don't have anything to invest.
Sorry,
she said, her voice fading slightly.
I need to call Hoyt before I head back to sit with Mom. She's going a bit stir-crazy locked up in that facility.
Poor Mom, I said, frowning. She hated hospitals even before Dad died. When can she get out of there? Polly sighed directly into the phone.
It's going to be a few more weeks. They'll want to make sure the cancer is gone before they release her.
I bet she's not happy about that. How long can that take?
She's not. Could be weeks, months. They don't know.
I could hear Polly's TV blaring in the background, as if she'd just raised the volume. There were faint sounds of sirens and a voice speaking quickly over the noises. When can I talk to her? I asked.
I'm not sure. Maybe tonight? I'll ask the nurse when I get back there, Polly said.
Her voice had started to fade.
There's something going on not far from here. I gotta go. I'll talk to you later, okay?
I swallowed hard. What's going on?
I'm not sure, Polly said. I haven't ventured out much around town, so I don't know the area well. I've only been at the hotel or with Mom when possible. Oh, and this divine bagel shop on the corner. It's probably all I've eaten since arriving. Anyway,
Polly's voice became a fuzzy, jumbled mess. I couldn't make out the last few words before she was gone. I stared at the phone for a few moments before I pushed the chair back and walked over to the small TV in the living room. The volume was at full blast from the last time Freddie had watched his shows in a drunken stupor. I frantically lowered the volume, then clicked through the channels, stopping at the breaking news on the local channel. My heart thudded sharply. Whatever it was that was happening in New York was occurring at the facility my mother was receiving her treatment. My first thought was that there was a fire. My second thought was that there was an active shooter. I couldn't make sense of the words rushing across the bottom of the screen, or the words coming from the confused newscaster's lips. The only thing that was clear was that something was wrong. Something was terribly wrong. Chapter 2. I frantically tapped in the only number I had for the facility. No one answered. It just kept ringing and ringing and ringing.
"We just got an update from those inside," the newscaster announced as he pressed his fingers to his ear. "The new Burberry Medical Research Facility is on lockdown. I repeat, the facility is on lockdown."
"Lockdown?" I asked, squinting at the TV.
Our sources say they are handling the situation. There are no further updates at this time,
the smooth-faced man said, before repeating the same things he'd said since I'd turned on the TV. I tried to call Polly again, but she didn't answer. I stood there with my arms crossed as I stared at the TV, feeling absolutely helpless, worried, frightened. The only thing I could think to do was to call Hoyt. Polly and Hoyt had been dating for 5 years and engaged for one of those, but still, he wasn't one of my favorite people to talk to. He thought I was lazy. I thought he was a self-centered, conceited asshole. He always had this look on his face, as if he knew all my secrets, and that he thought he was better than I was.
Hello, Mr. Parker's office,
his secretary said in her perky southern accent. Can I speak with Hoyt, please?
May I ask who's calling, please?
It's Kit, I said firmly.
Oh, hello, Kit,
she said in an even bubblier tone. She knew me from the times I'd gone with Polly to the office, but even if she hadn't known me, she probably would have pretended to.
Hoyt's in a meeting. I'll have him call you back soon, okay?
I chewed my fingernail. Thanks. One of my most hated things in the entire world was not being able to reach someone when I needed to. I had nightmares about it. And here I was, unable to reach anyone. It wasn't so much a worry about Hoyt, because I already knew it was unlikely he'd call me back after getting the message. He might call Polly to respond, though, and that was all I wanted. The rest of the day, I paced, waiting for updates, even though the TV channels had gone back to their regularly scheduled programming. If something were really wrong, someone would be talking about it. It would be big news. There would be constant coverage. Polly would have called me. The front door squeaked as it opened, and I heard the familiar sound of Maddie's backpack dropping to the floor. She didn't say anything before walking down the hall and closing her bedroom door. Things between Maddie and I were currently in a strange place. I loved her more than life itself, but she didn't understand why we were still living with her dad. She'd heard every fight we'd ever had since she was 5. I could still remember when she was 7 years old and asked with tears streaming down her face if we could go live with Grandma. I should have been stronger, but I didn't have the money to move out. It was hard because even though Freddie didn't act like it, he was still her father. I wanted things to be better between them, even if he wouldn't ever go back to being the man I married. Maddie couldn't wait until she turned 18 in a few months because she planned to move out. She didn't have money or a job, but she was determined. Grandma would help her. At least, that's what she told me one night when we hadn't been getting along. I knocked on her door. How was school today? Fine, she shouted through the thin wood. Can I get you anything? A snack? Soda? I could hear her groan. I'm on the phone, Mom. We can talk later, okay? Yeah, sure. No problem. Okay, now walk away from the door. I sighed as I went back to stand in front of the TV. Nothing new. I tried to call Polly again, but still, she didn't answer. My stomach was twisted into a tight knot. My feet padded back and forth along the already worn carpet. It felt like spiders were crawling all over my body underneath my clothing, and no matter how hard I tried, I couldn't brush them away. Anxiety was rippling through my body, growing and growing into the waves of a perfect storm. I couldn't just sit in the house waiting, but I didn't have a choice. There wasn't anything I could do, miles and miles and miles away. It was about an hour later when my phone buzzed. I smacked my hand down on the phone as if it were going to run away before I could answer. Hello? I answered without looking to see who was calling. I was able to see Mom, Polly said. And? They sent me home almost as soon as I got there, Polly exhaled. It's really strange over there. Mom started to have a seizure, and they made me leave the room. I kept asking if she was okay, and they said she'd be fine, that it was a rare side effect. I chewed the inside of my cheek. Was this something they discussed with you?
They didn't mention it at all during the initial meeting. Maybe they said something to Mom, I guess. Anyway, they sent me home, and on my way out, Polly said, swallowing so hard I could hear the gulp through the phone. There were other patients in their rooms having the same reaction.
All at the same time?
Yep.
That's weird, right?
It's totally weird. They escorted me and a few other people out of the building before putting the whole place on lockdown.
I glanced at the TV. That was on the news. I'm surprised they let you go in.
I found a way in. What are they saying on the news there?
Nothing much. Doesn't seem like the reporters really know what's going on.
Polly said. I could hear her tapping her fingers on something through the phone. Mom seemed okay just as I was being ushered out, but I didn't like it. I didn't like it at all. Leaving her after that episode was really hard.
I ran my fingers along the rough edge of the table. Did they tell you anything else? Like, when you can see her again?
They said they'd call, Polly said. The doctors and nurses seemed calm, but the looks on their faces told a different story. I could see it in their eyes, Kit.
What could you see?
They were scared, truly frightened. It seemed as though they didn't know what was happening, even though they said they did.
Polly hesitated.
I'm so worried about Mom. I tried to call the facility several times for an update, but no one answers. I'll try going back again when the fire trucks leave, but for now, all I can do is wait. They told me when I was leaving not to worry, that she was in good hands.
My eyes were locked on the TV, as if staring at it would force them to provide more information. Do you believe them?
I don't know.
Her words came out painfully slowly.
I don't know, she said with a sigh. I want so badly to just take her out of there, but they wouldn't allow it. There was such a rush to get me away from her and out of the building. I heard a word, at least I think I did, as I was being dragged out of the building.
What word did you hear? There was a long moment before she spoke again. The spider started to crawl under my skin again.
Quarantine.
Quarantine? I asked, scrunching up my nose. Are you sure?
No. Like I said, I thought that's what they said, but I wouldn't bet any money on it. At least, not a lot.
I knew my sister well. Everyone who met us always thought she was the older one because she was so confident, in charge. But she was younger than me. And even though she wanted to be strong and take care of everyone, I could tell when she was faking it. Polly was never very good at hiding how she really felt from me.
I need you to do me a favor, Polly said.
What do you need?
Hoyt isn't returning my calls. I wanted to update him on what's going on in case he's worried, Polly said. He's been working on some things for the wedding and work. I know he's busy, but can you stop by the hotel when you get a chance and see him? Update him if you want, but make sure he picks up his damn phone and calls me.
I said, trying to think of a way out of seeing Hoyt. It was bad enough I was going to have to see my husband in a few hours. Seeing her fiancé was not something I'd planned on doing today. Polly groaned.
Please, I'll send you gas money.
Polly, I said with a sigh.
What?
Don't be like that. I could walk to the hotel if I wanted to.
Well then, help your sister out, okay? I don't ask much of you, do I?
She didn't wait for an answer.
I kind of have a full plate here. One second, Polly said.
It wasn't a long wait before she spoke again.
That was the facility. I need to take this.
I pressed my lips together. They made a small popping noise as I opened my mouth to speak. I'll get a message to Hoyt. I actually called him earlier when I couldn't get a hold of you, but he was so busy he couldn't call me back, apparently, I said. Update me as soon as possible, okay?
I will,
Polly said, instantly ending the call. I wanted to tell her to let my mom know I loved her and that I was thinking of her, but she didn't give me the opportunity to say anything more.
It was hard enough that I had to stay behind when my mom was going through so much. I should have been there with her. I grabbed my phone and my keys before knocking on Maddie's door. I need to run out for a bit. I'll be back soon, okay? Yes, fine, Maddie called back. I exhaled as I walked out the front door and plopped down into my old rust-sprinkled Ford. There was a quarter tank of gas left, but it would be more than enough to drive the few blocks to the hotel Hoyt owned. My hands were at 10 and 2 as I drove down the road at the precise posted speed limit. It had taken less than 10 minutes to pull into one of the parking spots at the 10-story, 5-star hotel. As I walked toward the building, I felt drastically underdressed compared to the other people coming and going. The men all wore their pressed suits, and the women all in their tight pencil skirts with perfectly poofy blouses. Every woman had nearly the same hairstyle, with her hair pulled back into a tight, sleek ponytail or bun. I walked past the front desk like I'd done with Polly many times before and headed down a hallway that led to the office area. The glass door was being cleaned by the custodian as I arrived. Hello, he said softly as he opened the door for me. Hi, I said, and the main receptionist looked up at me. I gave her a wide smile. I'm here to see Hoyt Parker.
Do you have an appointment?
She asked, keeping her eyes on her computer screen. I chewed my lip for a second as my eyes scanned the rows of office doors stopping at Hoyt's door. Not exactly. I decided to lie, even though I was terrible at it. He is expecting me, though. I walked toward his office door and placed my hand on the glass. The wheels of her chair squeaked on the tile floor as she stood.
You can't go in there, the receptionist said, with a panicked look on her face. Not until I talk to his secretary.
No, it's okay. I'm his soon-to-be sister-in-law, I said, pushing the door open. The receptionist quickly picked up her phone and pressed one key. She started talking to someone.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.